Welcome to this very special edition of Indianomics. Special because I have with me Dr. YV Reddy, former governor of the Reserve Bank of India, and of course, chairman of the 14th Finance Commission more recently, one of the best commentators on Indian economy. Dr. Reddy, thank you very much
thank
for
you.
Joining me. First of all, how would you explain this contradiction? You know, we are at a time when we have the lowest quarterly GDP growth in 20 quarters, and yet we have the best political will probably 26 years, a government returning with a great majority. Do you think this political will and mandate can be resolved for an economy which seems to be most broken given the last 5 years?
No, I won't say it is most broken or anything like that. But the fact remains that in the last few years, the potential output, admittedly, the potential output has not increased.
Mm.
The savings, household savings are a little down. I think the households are more indebted than before, relatively. So in a way, their balance sheets are leveraged.
Mm.
The government balance sheet, as you know, is both center and states together.
It's leveraged.
And also the fudgeting, which often happens, it appears to be more than usual, with the result the numbers also are a little suspect. And in this type of situation, on top of it, the global uncertainties have suddenly escalated. We have definitely the possible recession is being talked about, US trade war, China, then Iran crisis. So I think there are two things that are happening. Domestically, economy is not as strong as it was before, inherently. Global uncertainties are there. These are, in a way, areas of concern. But definitely the fact that there is a regime stability. See, I make a distinction between system stability and regime stability. Indian political system is stable. Even in 1890, the system was stable.
Yes.
But the regime was not stable.
Yes.
Now we have got system stability and regime stability. Therefore, I don't expect a crisis like the investors running away or something like that. But on the other hand, our economy is also a little more resilient, but it's a lot more open economy. So therefore, the hit can be taken by various economic agents, though it may not be a crisis.
Okay, but clearly the potential growth or the expected growth of India seems to have declined. I mean, we thought we are almost a God-given right to 8%. Now 7 is a struggle.
Yes, for two reasons, definitely. See, ultimately, there are two things which are required. You require investment, backed by savings, and you require productivity. There is no evidence of growth in total factor productivity. And actually, the household savings are down. And therefore, how do you increase the potential output unless you increase the investment and or productivity?
Okay. Now, the usual two resources to increase productivity and develop economic growth are monetary resource and fiscal resource. What is your comment on the monetary resource?
Basically, I think essentially productivity depends on the real economy.
Yes.
The labor market, technology, that's what the productivity. But the financial sector and monetary, fiscal and monetary management can aid productivity growth, can enable productivity growth. For instance, if the government is able to borrow, invest and attract private investment, increase the productivity, that's one way. The other way is you can also use it for consumption, but it's not necessary that all consumption is bad. Ultimately, the consumption also has to demand. So the fiscal and finance are means of enhancing productivity. That did not happen.
Okay. Let me start with the monetary space that is available and then come to how much fiscal space is available. You know, the usual argument is that the real rates are still high. The inflation is under 4% even at the end of the year. And interest rates even after the rate cut is 5.75. You think that therefore there should be monetary space?
See, again, the question is empirical evidence as well as the contextual reality. Is there empirical evidence that the growth and investment is elastic to interest rate changes? I'm not sure that there is. Just look at the empirical evidence before we conclude. Secondly, contextually, what is the constraint on investment? Is it the cost of capital?
Exactly.
Or are there other constraints? I think the policy prescription will depend on not what is called a basic hypothesis, but what I would say the contextual reality.
Okay. We are faced with a new reality in terms of inflation. In the last 24 months, it has been around 4%. But in the 70 years prior to that, the average was 7.5%. And even if you take the last 30 years since 1991, the reforms, the average has been around 5 to 6%. So should we assume that this is a temporary aberration and that we may mean revert?
I would divide into three components: food, fuel, and others. Now, if you break up, I think the oil prices have been very benign, and that's more because of the global oil prices than us. As far as food prices are concerned, I think overall, over a period, the food prices, food inflation has been somewhat constrained because the supply of food is now more or less inelastic, and so is the demand. It's sort of settled down.
Okay.
The issue is the...
If that is true, then we should have benign food inflation.
I presume so. I would think so. And it has been so, I thought, for the last 5 to 10 years, except for a brief while.
In between 13 to 15, we did have high food prices as well.
Two years. But globally also, another thing is globally, non-food, non-fuel inflation has been subdued.
Yes.
And therefore, in a way, if you recall, we were also going towards 5%, ceiling of 5%, 3 to 5%.
Yes.
So it is a long-term trend. But I think now, in a way, we are closer to the global inflation, provided that it's, however, this will not be applicable as far as food and fuel are concerned.
Okay. The point I'm asking you is that can we now believe that we are in a lower trajectory for a sustainable period?
See, in fact, the question is whether the monetary policy should take credit.
Okay.
Or is it because the supply and demand factors, which have been taken care of in a particular manner. So the limited point I am making is that given our situation, the capacity of the monetary policy to influence inflation is somewhat limited.
Okay. No, I take your point that lower interest rate
both because of the dominance of fisc in determining the food and fuel prices.
Okay.
Second, the autonomous nature of their supply, and third is the transmission mechanism, both through the banking system and administered interest rates. So a configuration of all these forces makes monetary policy far less effective than is assumed in theory.
Okay. Well, let me come to fiscal space. Do you think the government has the fiscal space to stimulate investment and consumption?
The way I look at it is, in a way, the high interest rate for the borrower and in a way low interest rate for the saver is because of financial repression. Fiscal sustainability is happening because of financial repression.
Okay.
And also because in the recent past you have allowed government paper to be picked up by non-residents. And then there's a lot of monetization of the government debt by the RBI. So in a way the fiscal sustainability that you see is at a cost. And that cost can't be incurred repeatedly.
Okay. And that cost is hurting growth, you would say.
But at the same time, there are issues in the economy which are stalling growth. And those issues will have to be resolved. And that may require fiscal support. So in a way, in the short term, you have to have a targeted stimulus without sacrificing the medium-term fiscal consolidation.
Okay.
Something like a pause.
A pause for 1 year
or 2 years
on fiscal on consolidation fiscal is advisable?
But that has to be in the following way, in the sense that it should not be on the tax side because it's really difficult. And how it will respond will depend on the taxpayer. Expenditure is better. Targeting is better through expenditure. And infrastructure solution is not exactly right because infrastructure, by the time you devise new projects, so it should be acceleration of the projects. But I believe that the greater scope for stimulus through public enterprises.
Okay.
Central public enterprises and state public enterprises, they are less leveraged. compared to private sector.
So they should be made to invest.
They should be made to accelerate the projects. And also those projects which are somewhat incomplete because of the fiscal stress. So you can pick up the projects which are close to completion and acceleration of implementation. So like that, they should be targeted with a making sure that it is not a recurring commitment.
Okay. No, that sounds like a very sound plan. I just want one more word on the fiscal space. You are saying, you said targeted stimulus for a brief period.
Yeah.
Now, already we don't see enough appetite for government paper. That is one reason why, despite interest rate cuts, corporates are not able to borrow. The gap between the overnight rate, which is the repo rate, and the 10-year government bond is the highest ever, almost the highest ever in history. So clearly there is no appetite. Then why are you recommending more fiscal stimulus?
Because it is possible to convince that the debottlenecking of the growth irritants will happen.
Okay.
So it's not purely a finance phenomenon. The question is that if we are able to say that this is targeted, that's what I said, targeted. Mm. For instance, the bank capital, if that is the constraint, then you provide for the bank capital.
Okay.
Or projects which are stalling, where quickly returns can be brought. So, in a way, my own preference will be that you create a separate fund, a stimulus fund.
Okay.
And the stimulus fund will be quantified, set apart. That's number one way. And second way, of course, is, as I mentioned, identify the public enterprises where you make them use for investments.
Okay.
By borrowing from the market.